that research on various fronts. So some of us have been involved in a survey of the existing literature, relevant literature, and previous work that's been done along these lines. And we've also made use of contacts with charities and other organizations who work in the homeless. And we've got a couple of surveys that we've released online. One is for professionals who work with homeless people, and one is for the service users themselves.
Mm-hmm.
But in addition, we've done some face-to-face qualitative surveys.
Okay.
So it would be really useful to hear a little bit about, you know, your experience along those lines and how, you know, we might present whatever we do in the best, you know, most effective way.
Okay, yeah. So somebody said it might be too far down. You might be too far down the road of maybe some of this presentation. But at least I can tell you the general principles of doing market research, and at least you'll know where some of the limitations are if you're being realistic about what you've achieved.
Absolutely.
Yeah?
That would be very, very helpful.
Okay.
Thank you.
Well, I'll just tell you my background while we're waiting. Okay.
Yes.
So thank you very much for having me. I'm a market researcher by background, pure market researcher. When I left school, I went to work for research company called Maury, who you might know from Maury Coles from election times. I started there as a graduate trainee nearly 20 years ago. So my background is in sort of pure sort of scientific, robust research. I spent 15 years at Ipsos Maury, from being a trainee in London right up to being an associate director before I left Ipsos Maury 4 years ago to set up my own research business. Now I specialize in my specialty is actually interviewing politicians on behalf of organisations, so a bit different from this, but this is sort of, but my background, when I was at Ipsos Mori over 15 years, I did everything from all forms of research, qualitative and quantitative. I'll come in to explain the difference between the two if you don't know the difference between qualitative and quantitative, from doing exercises which were sometimes for very big organisations like you know, the Coca-Colas or the BPs or of this world, right through to smaller organisations doing social research in local communities, understanding residents or understanding challenges faced by particular groups in society. All kinds of research for all kinds of different organisations. And even also at one time I was involved with, before the dot-com bubble burst, showed my age, so I suppose 15 years ago, 16 years ago, I worked in what was called eMori at the time, which was driving research using the growth in mobile phones and the internet and online media to look at where there were opportunities for business and for society as well. So a little while ago, but I'll try and draw my knowledge back then of what we expected would come out of society with the use of internet and mobile phones. And then I remember back in those days, though, we were tracking about last time we did this, we used to do technology tracker every week to see the general public, where everyone, what proportion of uptake there was of mobile phones. And even then, it was only about 40% of the public had a mobile phone back then. So it shows you it's been how quickly things have gone. That was 99. So only 40% of the public had a mobile phone in 99. And now somewhere around about 80 to 90% of the population have a mobile phone. So anyway, the world has changed a little bit. So I'll just tell you, if you're going to do some market research, I'll tell you some sort of general principles on what makes for a good research project. So this is not a fantastic presentation. I've just put some thoughts and some slides to help with some discussion. By all means, ask me questions as I come along. I'm Robert, by the way. So if you're going to do a research project, there are a number of things you have to think about from the outset. You shouldn't just leap into a research project. It's a bit like all the things, it's a bit tiresome, people tell you, but you have to prepare for everything. You know, if you're every element, really the groundwork is done before you actually go out and see anyone. The first element you have to think about very carefully is really realistically what you want to achieve out of doing market research. You can't achieve everything. Have a very clear set of objectives. That means sitting down on a piece of paper and realistically put down what you want at the end of the day to have found out. What information do you need to gather? What understanding do you need to have? You work backwards from your objective, because your objectives effectively write your questionnaire or write your topic guidance qualitative research. if you don't know what you're trying to find out at the end of the day, you're kind of lost. You'll just be writing anything on a piece of paper. So you've got to know, first of all, you've got to know your survey objectives. And the second element is sample. And most people don't really think about sample enough because your research will only be as good as your sample. Regardless of how good your questionnaire is, you can spend weeks on writing a questionnaire. At the end of the day, the people you've interviewed aren't the right people. It's like an utter waste of time doing a piece of research. So if you can't, you have to understand, and before you can even understand what your sample is your small group that you actually research. Before you understand your sample, you have to know the population. And I don't mean the population necessarily of the general public. You have to understand the population of the group that you're trying to research. So whether that's homeless, you have to understand the profile of homeless people, and you have to understand if you're only doing your research in Edinburgh, you have to understand the profile of homeless people in Edinburgh. If you're wider than that, if you want to look at those who are socially excluded, you have to understand what that definition means. You have to understand who those people are. So those will include other people like older people. It'll include people in households who perhaps where one member of the household dominates, whether that's digital provision or telecommunications provision. Some people forget that if you might have a husband in the household who decides on what mobile phone the rest of the family has, what level of internet access the rest of the family has. It might be that some people in the family just leave it to their partner to do everything. So they don't even have an email address. They don't ever access the internet. There are hidden groups of society that are digitally excluded, not just the obvious ones like homeless people who don't necessarily have a mobile phone or internet access. So you've got to do a lot of work, and I'm trying not to overemphasize it, but you have to do a lot of work to understand your sample first. Then sample size you have to decide, if you're going to do a quantitative survey, you have to decide how many interviews you're going to do. And even within that number of interviews you're going to do, you're going to say, am I going to chop up that number of interviews? Say I'm going to do 100 interviews. Am I realistically wanting to look at any differences within that 100 interviews? Do I want to look at the differences between those who are under 25 and those who are over 65? Because if you've only interviewed in that 100, you've only interviewed 3 or 4 people who are under 25, you realistically you won't have any reliable results for that group. That'd just be randomly 3 people that you've interviewed, and that's not a representative reflection of opinion. So often when you're designing the sample, you have to work on you'll know the population, you'll know therefore the number of interviews you want to achieve. You can say 5% of the population will be under 25, 5% of my sample needs to be under 25. How many interviews would that be in 100 interviews? If it's only 4 people, that's not enough. I need double the sample size, because I need every little group that I want to look at, I have to have a robust number of interviews within that subgroup of interviews. So that will build up effectively decide the sample size you realistically need to have. Even then, I should point out that the reliability of a small sample size is going to be poor. To give you an example, if you're interviewing 1,000 members of the general public, and I was to take a subset of that, say I was to take, I'm trying to remember my stats, if you get somebody who's over 65, we represent about 40% of the population, and the reliability on any figure of people who are over 65 on a sample of 1,000 general public exercise, the reliability of that figure will be about 7 or 8% either way. So if some 50% of 65-year-olds say that they don't have access to the internet, then I know the real result is either going to be, it could be anywhere between 50% and 58%, or between 42%. So there's a big margin of error. Just because you haven't interviewed everybody, you always know there's going to be some groups of people you haven't interviewed within your sample. So if you've interviewed 100 people, the factors that are going to influence the reliability of that data depends on how accurate that 100 people were, a reflection of the population. It's going to rely on whether you've been able to get to all types of people within that group. So those people who are on the street, those people who are in sheltered accommodation, those who are vulnerable, perhaps who are not easily accessible. So there's bias all the way through. There's challenges all the way through in trying to make sure your sample is reliable. And then in any one statistic, you know there's going to be a big margin of error on it. The next one is the method of collection. Sometimes it's not appropriate. Sometimes there's two different, so there's broadly there's two different kinds of research, of method collection. You can be qualitative and you can be quantitative. And qualitative research is when it's not about collecting numbers and percentages, it's more about having detailed conversations with people or bouncing ideas off different people. So you're understanding and you're getting detail and reflection and opinions and values of people. It's not about having statistics. And then you have a quantitative side, which are a number of methods which are used for filling out questionnaires or in other ways to get stats on people. So sometimes you have to decide which is more appropriate depending on the audience. You can't get to everybody in your population. Probably you're going to end up just doing with what you can in qualitative rather than doing quantitative exercise. I'll come on to the pros and cons of the different methods in a minute. Analysis of results is also another element you have to think about up front, because can you practically manage if you've got 100 questionnaires or 300 questionnaires? How will you process those? What will the format of the results look like? Will you be breaking down those results into different groups? If it's qualitative, will you be recording those discussions? Will you be transcribing them? Will you be reviewing? How will you review 300 depth interviews? There's a practical challenge in that. There's always, if it's a proper research exercise, if I was doing research exercise for a client, I have two other complications. I have a budget and I have a timetable, because at the end of the day, a client will want results by a certain date. Usually a client will have to either publish a piece of research or they have to make a decision on something, and therefore they need the research in order to make a decision by a certain time. So there's usually a timetable. And then realistically, there's always a budget for an exercise. We'd always love to spend hundreds of thousands of pounds on doing a really, really large, robust exercise interviewing every member of society, having a good sample size and be able to chop that up and reliably having results for each individual group. But at the end of the day, you can't always do that. So those are some of the things you should be thinking about. If you haven't done that already, you should go through that list and understand why you've made decisions at different elements. And that should start to structure your research exercise. Some of the things I've mentioned on the sample, that just to point out, some things like census or sample. A census is when if you can interview everybody in a group, you would try and do that. But in the end of the day, you can very rarely interview everyone, even if you're doing a staff survey, for example. At the end of the day, you're probably not going to get to absolutely every member of staff. But so often it's one of the first things you have to consider, whether it's sample or census. And if it's sample, then you need to design a structure for those interviews that you're going to do. Sometimes called a sample frame. How do you construct a representative sample? So that's you understanding what the population is, the profile of the population, breaking it down by age groups, by other characteristics. You want to try and get as much detail on any characteristics that would affect the results. So maybe I'm making this overcomplicated, but you need to have some criteria. You need to have some criteria in your sample. And the criteria should be those that you think... all those factors that have an influence on your end results. So age is probably going to have an influence on social digital inclusion. Ethnicity, possibly. There's some cultural challenges to digital inclusion. Socioeconomic group, so whether you're rich, poor, household income or individual income, that's probably going to have an influence on it. So you need to have some populating some statistics on that.
Have you been talking about where you're not too sure about what characteristics
of
the results?
Yeah, it's
pretty much the case here.
Yeah.
Students learning as they're going.
It does show you need to know your background research. You need to know, to an extent, you need to know something about your topic before you really leap into doing a market research exercise. You can make some. It's fair to say sometimes some things you know, gut instinct will tell you that those factors are likely to be influential. Sometimes you just have to collect other data in your survey and then to see to what extent there are differences by certain groups. So there's a little bit of general knowledge to start with, and some of it's a bit of luck. I should say, when it comes to your survey, you should never be collecting any information in your survey that you don't need. So don't ask questions about... So if we're doing a survey on digital inclusion, probably not going to ask questions about what would be completely irrelevant. Sense like even sort of sexuality is probably not going to be necessary. Would you do, if I'm going to ask about ethnicity, I would keep it very broad. Maybe I wouldn't even necessarily need to record much detail. Just be careful when you, just be careful. Just things you can make some assumptions up front, but don't collect too much information, too much personal information. Come on to why that's, in a bit more detail, why you should need to be careful in questionnaire design. But anyway, so a little bit, if you can, understand your population and factors and what you think might influence it. And then you set, what you do is you set quotas. And quotas are, so within your 100 interviews, you know that 25%, say, are under 25. So 25 of your 100 interviews should be with that particular group. That makes some sense? So you've designed how you're going to do your sample. Then look for whether there might be some bias. So trying to avoid bias is particularly important. So bias is things like, trying things of obvious, different kinds of bias, things that might lead results. So you might, for example, some groups are easier to interview than others. So it's easy to go to, say it's easy to go to, excuse me if I make some wild assumptions, but inappropriate assumptions, but it'd be fairly easy to go to a shelter, a homeless shelter, and just interview those people there. Inherently, you're biased by the type of person who's already, they may perhaps a stronger character, so they've been able to take themselves away from a difficult situation. So they might be a bit more generally aware of society. They might be a bit better informed or educated, motivated. So you've already got some kind of bias because they're a certain type of person who can take themselves to a shelter. There's a whole load of, and I know there will be a whole load of other people who are not in that situation. Perhaps they are strong enough to leave the situation they're in. Perhaps they're on the streets. Perhaps they're hidden homeless. They're going from sofa to sofa. So you've already, just by the way you've decided to do your survey, you're already excluding some people from your results. So as much as possible, you've got to try and avoid these types of inherent error in the way you've done your exercise. And then will my results be sufficiently robust? If you're doing a survey, I touched on it already. I mean, it depends on the level of detail you're going to go to in your survey. I suggest what you do is I didn't bring one with me, but you can go on Google. If you look for market research and statistical reliability, you'll find little spreadsheets that you can look at. But I know something I've got here. If it's 1,000 members of the general public, whenever you see polling for an election, they always say that the result is about 3-4% either way. So for example, when the EU referendum polling was taking place last year, it was actually the polls were somewhere between sort of 52% leave and 47% leave. And every polling company would tell you that's just far too close to be able to run. That means it could be completely the other way. So, and it came to the general election as well, when it was whether Conservative or Labour, it was just far too close for even the Scottish independence referendum, to be fair, got so close in the end. When it gets within about 6%, So 3% either way, it's really impossible for a market research to get any more accurate than that. So they hate it when polling companies hate it when it's that close. They'd rather be far apart so they can have that margin of error. But I have got in here some basic stats just to give you a feel for it. Here we go. So usually they say if it's general public and you do a sample size of 200 interviews, reliability will be 6.9%, 7% either way. And that's to the general public. And that's even setting quotas by age, gender, working status, ethnicity. So be aware that a statistical survey is likely to have a large margin of error. So I was going to talk to you about two... I'm already hinting towards the fact that a quantitative survey is probably not the best type of exercise. But anyway, there are two different kinds of it. So broadly, there are two different kinds of research. There's qualitative and quantitative. Qualitative, the purpose of qualitative research is to get an understanding, reasoning, understand opinions, attitudes, values, sort of what underlies opinions. It's a good exercise to help you develop, explore ideas. So if you have a hypothesis already, it's an opportunity for you to put that towards to those who are in that situation and test your theories with a group. You're not there to try and measure anything. Quantitative exercise is the opposite. Usually a quantitative exercise, I have to say, is done after qualitative. So you've got a good feel you've got a hypothesis, you feel like you've got a good understanding of the topic, but what you really need now is to put some stats to back up your hypothesis. So that's when you're doing something that's measurable, it's robust. If I'm being honest, it's more presentable to others. If you're going to somewhere like the Scottish Government or if I'm going to apply, at the end of the day, I always have somebody, if you do qualitative research, somebody says, well, yeah, that's great, So how many people is that? Or, you know, is that most or is that just a few? Really, that wasn't the purpose of the exercise. If you're doing something, if you're sending something to Scottish Government, they'll almost always want a quantitative exercise because they want confidence. People have confidence in stats, less so in something that's kind of woolly and iffy, kind of around the edges, kind of cozy sort of type exercise. But anyway, in qualitative exercise, you get two different kinds of qualitative. You get... interviews, in-depth interviews, and you get group discussions. There are in-depth interviews can be done in different ways. You can do that. That can be in streets. That could be in home. Can be on telephone. It is usually, this is qualitative, not quantitative. This is in-depth interviews would usually be open-ended. It means, what it means by that is that it's not about ticking off the responses on a list. It's usually open-ended questions are, why do you say that? You know, what's your reason behind that? Can you tell me the challenges you face? Open-ended, and you probe, keep asking, why do you say that? You keep probing with questions. You usually don't have a strict set of questions that you're going to go through. You usually just have a list of topics rather than actual questions. The questions will come in the discussion. You will ask, it's your skill to ask logical follow-up questions as somebody brings up a topic. It's a little bit, although you've got a structure, it's a little bit you having to keep your brain working as you're interviewing people. They're often, an advantage of in-depth discussions is that they're one-to-one. They're usually done in a private setting rather than sometimes they are in the street, but usually they're in a private setting, so you can discuss more confidential topics, more sensitive topics. I've even had discussions where I've been interviewing people about sexual health or drug and alcohol use, and people have been uncomfortable with answering those questions. So what I've done is I've actually had a separate piece of paper that somebody goes and fills out themselves and put in an envelope, and I seal the envelope. So you can actually do an element of very, it's a much better way of interviewing. One-to-one is much better for very sensitive subjects. So you might go to a household, for example, and interview somewhere where there's a domineering partner in that household. I know we've had situations where a husband would sit in an in-depth interview with somebody, and we'd have a questionnaire that they would fill out on their own and put into a put into the into an envelope, and then I take it straight away. You have to. There's a skill involved in this type. I should say, sort of underlying. There's a. You have to be a good interviewer. Not everyone makes a good interviewer. You have to be throughout these types of conversations. You need to be enthusiastic, encouraging, supportive, sensitive to the type of person. Sometimes maybe you might decide I'm not the right type of person to do that interview. You know, if it's sometimes you might not have a man interviewing a woman. You might not. Sometimes you might not have a young person interviewing an older person. You might not have. So there's an element of thinking about what type of person is the right person to do those interviews as well. So there are some downsides. Just to say the downsides of doing those types of interviews. Obviously, it's hugely time intensive to go out and interview people. So usually the sample size is quite small, but the idea is to get detail rather than quantity. And you're not quantifying results because it's qualitative rather than quantitative exercise. Group discussion is a bit different. I always loved group discussions. It was always my thing. Qualitative discussions are usually a bit like this. You have people around a table. It can be anywhere from, you could have three or four people. You could have, you need to be careful, the number of people. It becomes a bit unmanageable if you have more than about 10 people. There's some skill involved in trying to keep everyone engaged. You'll get, in a group of 10 people, you'll get some that are very vociferous. They want to dominate the conversation. But you'll get some people who are quite quiet. You're usually paying people to come along to as an incentive rather than a payment, but incentive to come along to you have to think about what's the appropriate type of incentive. Sometimes it's a drink that's appropriate. Sometimes that's inappropriate, depending on your audience. I've definitely had occasions where we've invited people to have a drink beforehand, before you go into the room to have a discussion, and I've had people just come along and get drunk and then get into discussion, take their drink into the discussion, and then I've had to ask people to leave. I can remember one terrible incident where I almost forcibly had to have someone removed. He was going into cupboards and everything in the room looking for So you need to be careful. And the pros and cons, again, it's usually an open-ended discussion. You've got some themes that you're running through rather than actual questions. And you might have some prompts. You might have a few questions that you definitely want to make sure you drop in there at some stage. But you need to be, you need to have some themes. You need to have a good idea of timing. It's usually you can get away with about an hour and a half. Although I once did one on chocolate, which went 2 hours, but that was okay. It's easy enough. If you've got something that's real fun, really fun, you can keep them going. You need to be sensitive about sort of so again, it's flexible. You're going with discussion. Sometimes you have to let people go off on a tangent. Remember, there's no right and wrong answers because people can have very wild opinions. You just have to say that sometimes you just have to take that. I've had horrendous things that people have said in discussion, but that's genuinely someone's opinion. So you just have to be respectful of that.
So when you're doing that for about an hour and a half, typically, it's all being recorded rather than somebody writing something down.
Yeah, usually you record. If you're doing it, you have to ask somebody's permission up front, whether that's a depth interview or a group discussion. I would usually have a tape recorder in the middle, and the first thing I would do is explain it's a confidential conversation, that I'm only doing this for research purposes. I'll explain the length of the discussion, that it's voluntary, and then I'll ask their permission if I can record. And if somebody says they're not comfortable with recording, then you just have to take notes. Or if you can bring somebody with you, like a colleague or somebody you're working with, a scribe, and explain who they are. It's probably unethical, as the word say, if you have somebody else with you and you've not explained who that person is. I've had clients who often want to insist on sitting in to group discussions. I have to introduce them. Which totally throws the discussion because especially if you're doing a discussion, say I was doing that discussion on chocolate and I said that Mr. Hershey's is sitting in the room, then it totally throws the discussion and they end up talking to Mr. Hershey rather than talking to you. So sometimes I would say, you know, it's one of my colleagues who's helping me with discussion. And I've had times when the client's absolutely desperate to talk. And I'll just say at the end, I said to them, I'll give you 5 minutes at the end if you want to answer any questions. because there'll be misconceptions that come up in the conversation, and your client will say, will want to butt in and say, that's wrong. So I said, you just have to shut up until the end. And then at the end, you can come in and explain who you are, and then you can answer some of their questions. You have to manage that discussion. Remembering it's and keep it friendly all the way through. Even if you don't like someone that you're chatting to, you actually just have to remain diplomatic and keep the discussion going. Keep those people down that are the loud ones, and make sure you keep asking those people that are the quiet ones. Often it's the quiet ones that have got really, really interesting insight, and they're sitting there thinking, don't really like this discussion. But you have to make sure everybody's giving their time, so you have to make sure everybody's contributing to the discussion. So there's just some, and there's some other things about, you know, some downsides. Again, it's expensive. Sometimes you have to hire a venue. Sometimes you have to get the people to the discussion or pay for their travel. Sometimes you have to pay for an incentive to encourage them to come along. The more professional, the wealthier the respondents, probably the more you've got to pay. unfortunately,
it's not an issue for us.
But it's a challenge. Some groups are impractical. So if I wanted to do a group discussion of chief executives, it's impractical to get them together. I'll never realistically be able to get a group of six chief executives. All have to give up their time, come along to a discussion. I'd have to pay them something. And I know it seems unfair to say it. The wealthier they are, probably the more you've got to pay. So for some groups, I might have to pay £100 for somebody to come along for an hour and a half group discussion. If it's a general public, usually it's about £30 or so, and a drink and maybe sandwiches or something. It's an evening time. So there's less, I should say, the other thing, sorry, I'm quite often, I hope this is okay, I'm just going, off in tangents thinking about things. Group discussions are a great way of showing things. You can do it in depth interviews as well, of course, showing lists or showing products, showing digital devices. It can be a great way of bouncing ideas off each other. So you can get one person raises something and you can ask somebody else and say, what do you think? And so you're bouncing, getting them to challenge each other. I think it's fair to say you can have sort of debate within participants. Really, you shouldn't be doing too much talking in these discussions. You're just trying to keep the conversation going. My best group discussions have been those where I barely had to say anything, and they just automatically go through the topics you want to cover. They're debating with each other. Everybody's enjoying the group discussion. Those are the best kinds of discussions. The qualitative research, my feeling is you want to probably be doing depth interviews or qualitative research if that's realistic. So the other downsides are, obviously, it's not quantifying anything. It's not so private. So it might not work for all of your discussion, all the research you want to do. I need to find a suitable location, and that might not. Maybe some practical challenge in getting the people you want to the places you want. Some other things, just some important things to think of, other things I might have mentioned, some of these in doing qualitative research, whether that's interviews or whether it's group discussions. You need to think about how you're going to recruit the people to participate, whether that's to recruit them to a depth interview or recruit them to a group discussion. There's a skill in itself in recruiting people. If you're a research company, you have skilled recruiters who go out there and find people. Remember, you want to have to, even though it's qualitative research, for your group discussions, you want to have a good cross-section of people. You don't, again, just want to go and do a group discussion in a sheltered accommodation. You want to try and begin including those other types of socially excluded. Even the person who goes to do the recruitment needs to be the right kind of person, because if the person feels intimidated by the recruiter, they're probably not going to say yes to helping you with the discussion. Must remember to think about where you're going to hold the discussion, whether it's in-home or whether it's somewhere else. There might be a reason why you might not want to hold the discussion where they're living. Who should moderate? Who should do the discussion, thinking about whether you're the right person. If it's younger people, maybe use a younger person. If it's older people, maybe use an older person. If it's all-female group, then use a female moderator. How long you can interview, again, think about what's the appropriate type of length you can get away with. Just in some of the other ones, I mentioned some of the other ones, alcohol can work to get people loosened up a little bit, but be careful with the use of alcohol. So probably don't have alcohol on the table if you're having a group discussion. Ask permission to record. You should do that at the start. Outline how long it's going to be. Remember, any research you do, the premise of any market research is it's voluntary and it's confidential. You don't do, and you should outline both of those. You're not obligated to take part. So you always explain you're doing this for a good purpose. Just try and understand the challenges that people face and hopefully find solutions that'll alleviate difficulty. And that it's confidential. Anything you give, be treated in confidence. It'll be aggregated. There'll never be no point will I be identifying the individuals and attributing comments to individuals. In the discussion, always start with something nice and easy, whether it's a depth interview or a quantitative exercise. Start with questions that everyone can answer, or start with something that's fun. So some discussions are a lot easier than others. So the chocolate one's dead easy. You just go straight in. You can pretty much go straight into chocolate. But if you're talking about sexual health or something, you might start with something completely different or something more fun, whether it might be a general conversation about, actually, I've done some random things. Just be creative. I've done random things like, talking about getting people to talk about a room in their house or something, or designing something, or somebody to think about something fun, so everyone can contribute in the discussion. And you start general in your discussion and get more and more specific as you get on. Possibly leave sensitive subjects towards the end, as much as possible towards the end. You don't want to turn people off or start excluding people at the start of the discussion. Avoid leading. It's an important part of being a moderator is that you don't, you give as little as possible. You should only really impart information that's helpful to the discussion. Don't start giving your own opinions. I'm not sure I really agree with that, or I don't think that's true. Everybody's opinion is valued, and it's got to draw out everything that people say. Ensure everyone contributes, so making sure you include the quiet people. And be careful managing your time as well. It's very easy in a group discussion to get carried away with the discussion and know there are other topics you want to explore. So one tip is although I discuss having a piece of paper which has some themes on it, I usually have what to the side of it, how long I want to spend on each topic, and even more detail than that. If you know the discussion's starting at 2 o'clock and I want to spend 5 minutes doing the introduction, I'll go from 2 o'clock to 2:05, and then I'll go from 2:05 to 2:15, 10 minutes on my next topic. So be very, and then you should have, it's a classic mistake of not having a clock or a watch with you when you're doing group discussion. So you totally run out of time, only get halfway through your discussion because it's so interesting. Or if you keep people late and everyone starts getting up and leaving. So some general tips. Some qualitative, just the last thing, just in terms of your actual guide. So you wouldn't write actual questions, don't necessarily write actual questions you want to ask, but there should be there are three types of questions you'd be asking. There'd be ones which are collecting facts. Those are quite useful to write down as you're doing. I usually do in a group discussion, we'll write the names of everyone. First thing I'll do is go around and get everyone to introduce themselves. And I usually ask them to say, can you say how old you are or where you live or whether you've got family? And I'd write those facts down on my piece of paper. Usually when you've got this group discussion, it's a good idea to keep using people's names. So if I say, Lisa, isn't it? So if you've not said anything for 5 minutes, I'd go, Lisa, what do you think? Just to really pull you in when somebody says your name, it's really puts you up on your toes and think I better get involved. So if you're collecting facts, some questions will just be collecting data that you can understand the people. Sometimes you'll be asking questions about feelings, so softer issues, but why do you say that? And sometimes you're collecting values, which is sort of understanding where people come from, the type of background they've got, whether there's a sort of structure to why they have certain attitudes. So start general, move to specific, use themes, don't necessarily use exact questions, and use materials as well if you've got things you can show people. Break up into other groups if you find the discussion's not going very well. Then you can sometimes say, why don't you two, can I give you two a topic to write some ideas down, you two write something down, you two write something, and then you get them back to just either hand it in or discuss them. And if you can think of tasks as well, that makes it more fun rather than people just sitting around the group group discussion, just talking all the time. Sometimes you can give them things to play with or to look at and to break up the hour and a half a little bit. So quantitative, I'll go on to quantitative as well. So different types of quantitative research. So this is much more when you're trying to measure things. So there are different types of quantitative exercise. There's face-to-face interviewing. Now, face-to-face interviewing could be in different places. It could be in the street, which is less and less common. Or it could be in-house. Those are generally two places. You might do it in a workplace or some other place as well. The pros are that it's good for a good way to check personal details, so you can understand who they are, their background, demographic information about that individual, so that when you so that they fit your criteria, and so that you can do some analysis once you've analysed the results. Because it's face to face interviewing, you can use materials, so you can show lists to people rather than trying to have to read out lists or having to ask unprompted questions because you're not there to show them anything. And interpersonal skills, in that you can be a bit more personable to the individual to try and elicit their enthusiasm in taking part. However, it's time consuming, and it's typically, because it's time consuming, it's expensive, because it takes somebody's time. You're presumably sort of volunteering your time to do it, so you're doing interviewing themselves, but if you're using interviewers, you have to pay for an interviewer's time. And if you've got quotas to fill, they can get 10 interviews in a day, and you need to do 1,000 interviews. It's hugely expensive. Telephone interviewing is the usual pros of doing telephone interviewing is it's quick. There's actually a telephone centre, Ipsos Mori's telephone centre is just around the corner here. There's about 3,000 people who go work out of that telephone centre. Not there all the time, but so there's a high number of people. They do all of the UK's telephone interviews are done around the corner. So there's a high number of people, so you can get through a lot of interviews very, very quickly. It's much cheaper than face-to-face. It's non-geographical, so it means that you can ensure people who live in all parts of the country. You can't realistically send many interviews up to Skye or to the Western to the Northern Isles, but telephone interviewing doesn't really matter where they live. However, it's getting more difficult. It used to be quite simple to do telephone surveys because everyone had a landline. A research company will have be able to draw telephone numbers quite easily. We'll exclude those that are the telephone preference service. That's increasingly become a problem for doing telephone surveys as well, because more and more in population opt out of phone calls. There are falling numbers of landlines, so you can't get hold of numbers. People are excluding themselves. Falling number of landlines. I think last time I looked, there's about you might know, there's about 20% of the population, 20% of households that don't have a landline now. So any landline at all. Young people don't tend to have a landline. They'll just have a mobile phone. Then it can be costly to set up and analyse as well. You have to do a lot of work beforehand to make sure your questionnaire is right before you start sending it off to get interviews done. Once you start, realistically, you can't stop. Postal surveys, less and less common now. That used to be a very common way of doing surveys. Postal surveys are just a self-completion exercise. So you get somebody fills it out themselves, put it in an envelope, and then either hand it back to you into a box or they put it in the post. It's generally pretty cheap. You can knock a questionnaire up yourself. You can photocopy it, or you can get a printer to do it. And it's quite good for sensitive subjects because people fill it out themselves. There's no giving you face-to-face any answers. However, you can't realistically ask any open-ended questions. I have to say, people just don't write in answers to questions. They'd much rather tell you. So you have to keep most of your answers as closed questions, tick box or list questions. No control over who responds to it at all. Generally find with postal surveys, there'll be those people who've got more time in their hands. They're generally older. They're probably a bit more affluent. So they're not a particularly great way. And you need to have a reason to participate. If you get a survey through and it's all through your household and it's a series of questions about what products you buy, it's a strange kind of person who fills out that kind of questionnaire. Well, we'll sign you up for a £1 free voucher to something or other. They're just those things just collect your details so they can sell them off to people who sell you products. So you've got it needs to be a topic they're already engaged with. Perhaps they've already involved in the exercise you're doing and quite happy to give you a response separately. Online surveys, actual fact, they're not much better than just a postal survey. They're very cheap. Yeah, anyone can. There are free tools available. You can knock up your own online survey and you just email it, the link to anyone. You can include visuals in it, so you can have pictures, graphics, maybe even videos so people can watch and then give responses to. You can send reminders to. You can track those people who've responded, so you can send another email out to those people to say, see, you haven't taken part. Please, can you respond to the survey? Yeah, so it's great. It's a little bit better than a postal survey. However, again, you still have no control over who responds to it. You tend to find a certain type of person who will engage in an online survey. It'll be somebody who's already digitally savvy, who's already engaged in doing surveys. They're probably more affluent. They've probably got more time. They, of course, have to have internet access as well. That's already a challenge for the groups that you're trying to include. So there's obviously some practical challenges. Omnibus surveys are... omnibus means it's a vehicle, it's everybody. It's usually a general public omnibus. So these are surveys that are done on a regular basis by market research companies. Anything like the general public polling or stats you see in a newspaper are usually done on somebody's omnibus survey. They are shared costs. So their market research companies are going to be doing those surveys anyway. And what they're trying to do is sell space on their survey. So you can buy a question on that survey. It'll be done by a professional. There'll be a rigorous scientific basis to how that sample is collected and designed and collected. It'll be done by experienced interviewers. It'll be as robust an exercise as you can get. However, on the downside, you have to, first of all, find one. You have to be able to pay for it. And I would say a question these days on a number of general public omnibus is probably going to be £1,000 per question. And it's difficult if you've got very specific audiences, niche groups of the population that you're trying to interview. So it's a great way to profile omnibus surveys. So if you're trying to understand how many people in society have certain attitudes, it's ideal. That would be the way you would do it. But if you're trying to understand the challenges faced by a very small group of people, it's not so easy. Hall tests, not done so much now, but hall tests are usually when you've hired something. Hall tests used to be done for new products, usually. So you would have, somebody would hire a hall or a room off a main street, and you'd have people in the street who are trying to recruit people off the street to come in and try a product and write out on a piece of paper what they thought of the product, what they liked and disliked about the product. I have to say, years ago, a company called Compaq had designed this gadget. It was called an iPack, and it was the first product in the UK that had internet access on it, and it could show videos, and you could keep your calendar on it, and you could access email on it. This was late 90s, and we specifically did a hall test in the city of London, so right off Liverpool Street Station. So it was the wealthiest people in London, and we hired a church and got the wealthiest people off the street to come and try this product because it was £700 or something for the product. So it was really exciting, no? It's because nobody had ever seen anything like it. So that was the sort of thing, when you've got a new product, you can get people off the street to try a new product and get real practical experience of using it. However, the challenge is obviously you've got to find the right venue for something like that. You've got to recruit people off the street to do that. And of course, what about those people who don't walk up and down the street? Are those people that are out there somewhere else? So you always know this. You're inherently biased by where you are and who comes in and takes part. Mystery shopping, if you ever wonder what mystery shopping is where you have interviewers or experience, people who are experienced at doing it who pretend to be a customer and they go in and buy a product or pretend to be interested. I once did it to pretend I was going to buy a Volvo car. So I had to,
oh, that's cruel. Yeah. You're a salesman.
Yeah, so I have to go in there and pretend I got caught out there. You give a very specific brief of what it is you've got to test. And I got given a very specific model of car that I was interested in. I didn't know anything about a car at all. So so it's real life experience, and you can often get caught out. And it's a good way to sort of assess consistency. If you go into one shop here and ask for something, go to another shop and ask for it there, how you're treated in different places. However, it's time consuming, and it does require a certain type of expertise in doing that sort of thing. In quantitative, I know you've designed a questionnaire or been doing it already, but there's a few things of general principles if you're designing a questionnaire that you need to think about. So first of all, you've got to maintain the respondent's enthusiasm and involvement in the exercise. So you've got to design questions which are relevant to that person, the people that you're interviewing. They've got to be, so they're not complicated, they're not long. Questionnaire shouldn't be more than is appropriate. Depending on the audience, you can get it. Might only need to, should, if it's in street or it's a sensitive topic. I don't think you want to be doing it for half an hour, 40 minutes. You want to be keeping it as short as possible. As a general rule, don't ask questions you're not going to do anything with. So keep it short. Communicating to respondent, just in terms of where it's necessary to impart information in order to be able to answer the questions, you should do that. Whether it's reading something out or whether it's explaining a question properly or explaining an issue, then you should do that when it's appropriate to do so. Help the respondent through answering the questions. So make sure they're understanding scales, for example, what you mean, but you shouldn't be using language anyway that's difficult to understand. I always work, when I'm writing a questionnaire, start with the lowest common denominator. Which makes it easier, actually. So it means you shouldn't be using technical language. You should be using very, very plain, simple language. Don't use complicated scales with 10 different options on it. Keep your scales as simple as possible. Avoid bias. So you should be, again, making sure you're interviewing the right people. Don't just stop the person you know is going to say yes. You should be trying to recruit those people that also say no. So if you're in the street, there's always always an inherent bias in the street, not just because you're just interviewing people who happen to be on the street, not those people who are housebound, but you always get there a certain type of person who will stop and take part in a survey on the street. The challenge is trying to make sure you're interviewing all the right people, making the interviewer's task easy. So sometimes you're not the interviewer, sometimes somebody else is doing the interview, so your questionnaire should be nice and simply laid out. In fact, probably design a questionnaire with in mind that you're not the one who's asking the questions, that you're going to give it to can somebody else do it? If necessary, you should really test the questionnaire before you go out and start interviewing. So, and get feedback on what worked and what didn't work, and you know how long it takes to do the survey as well. And always be thinking when you design the questionnaire, how am I actually going to process this questionnaire? Think about what the results of that questionnaire is going to tell me. I've had clients who often write questionnaires themselves. And then I said, at the end of the day, you're not even going to be able to quote the results to that question. It just makes no sense. You can't write a sentence which will tell the results of that question. Sometimes you have to think about what that question's going to tell you. Some styles, just to give you some examples, there are different types of questions you can use. So your frequency questions, so for example, how often, usually how often, if at all. And I usually, as a tip, usually put in a specific period of time. Because if you ask a general question like, how often do you access the internet? Well, that really depends, doesn't it? Some weeks I'll interview, this week I did it a lot, last week I didn't do it at all. So usually I would try a specific time period to be, so how often? And of course it means that some people won't have in the last week, but if you're doing it enough people and it's a robust sample size, that challenge should iron out. You say, how often have you accessed the internet in the last week? So people can be tight and specific in answering their questions. List questions. If you're in a survey, you should really you should have as much detail as you can for yourself. You've thought through every question, all the possible options, because you needed to process answers. You don't want to have lots of other responses. They can be prompted or unprompted. Prompted is when you show the respondent the list and say which of the following. Unprompted is where you might say you know which issues, and you've got the list in front of you and you're ticking them off. You're not necessarily showing them to the respondent. There are sometimes reasons why you might want to prompt, reasons why you might not want to prompt. See what comes top of mind, for example, rather than actually giving them a list. So use show card is when you've got a list, something that you hand to respondents for the show card. Don't use long lists, particularly if you're reading out anything. A classic mistake is that I think they say that people, there's always, when you read out a list, people always remember the first couple in a list and the last few in a list. So if you've got a long list, people will just say, they're thinking, I can't remember those ones that were in the middle. So if it's going to be a long list, you should really just show on a piece of paper. But if you're doing by telephone, for example, you can't do that. So two options can be, say, which of the following, as I read them out. And so you do, is it this one? Yes, no. This one, yes, no. If you're not going to do that, then just keep it a very short list, because people are realistically aren't going to hold that whole list in their head before answering. Open-ended questions, these are the ones where you haven't, you don't know what the responses are, you're likely to be. In quantitative, the bit of a challenge in quantitative research, because if you ask an open-ended question to 100 people, you'll get 100 different responses. So you have to think, how on earth what am I going to do with those 100 responses? But people do quite like the open-ended questions, because there's often something else that you haven't asked about, or they want to give a bit of explanation. So usually, and even in a quantitative survey, you will have one open-ended question just to sort of mop up what you haven't covered. Scale questions there are two different kinds of scale questions. You get those that are a balanced scale. You should always have, my belief is you should always have a middle point, which is a neither nor. And you have either side of that, you have the positive and you have the negative. So if it's how satisfied or dissatisfied you are, I'd say, are you very satisfied, fairly satisfied, neither satisfied nor dissatisfied, fairly dissatisfied and very dissatisfied? And you might have a don't know option as well. And I think genuinely people can be in the middle, and genuinely people can have no opinion. And sometimes it's worth really actually wanted notes and they had no opinion. But always keep your scale balanced. It's a classic way to undermine a result is when you realize that people have asked four elements of satisfied and then the rest of one element are dissatisfied. So you've inherently undermined your results, because there were more options for satisfied. But sometimes that doesn't work, so you might have a progressive scale. So, for example, the how often have you done something, you probably would have a scale for that. Or how important, which is in itself is a biased question, because you've said not said how unimportant is something. But I might occasionally say how important, and I'd go very fairly, not very, not at all. So as much as possible, I'm still trying to keep that valid scale. So just, I think as a last slide, sorry for whittering on, I hope some of it's helpful. Just some other sort of common tips. The person who founded Mori, so he was a sort of like our guru, it was a chap called Robert Worcester. He founded Mori, and he's sort of seen as the godfather of market research. And he always believed that you should have a hypothesis before you start a piece of research. So you should really have thought through the topic yourself and have a good understanding of what you think drives opinions. So really what the research is doing is trying to either validate or undermine your hypothesis. That will be a theoretical basis for the piece of research you're doing. So you probably do have, I would guess by now, you've probably got some strong assumptions on what drives social exclusion or digital exclusion. So when you're doing a piece of research, you want to go out and challenge your own beliefs. Why should they help? If you're trying to recruit people to take part, you know, people are doing this voluntarily. So if you want to get a good response either to in-depth interviews, group discussions, or a survey, use good language to try and explain to them why it's important they take part. You value their opinion. You might not be paying them, but you could try and explain to them, you know, who you are. It's probably a sell in itself what you're trying to do. That, you know, so think about why. There'll be some people, there'll be different motivations for different people in taking part. So you need to try and think about what the right language to use to people. Don't ask for what you don't need. It's particularly in personal, if you're collecting personal details of people in a survey, people get very sensitive about collecting personal details. If you're not going to do anything with it, if you're not going to do anything with somebody's question on somebody's sexuality, then don't ask it. Just ask no more than you need. Less is, in other words, less. Also, less is more. The shorter your survey, the shorter the depth interview, the more people you'll get to respond to it. Am I confident I understand the issue? So, in that, do you feel like, have you done your own groundwork? Sometimes you can claim ignorance, and that's quite helpful in itself. Sometimes you can say, I don't really understand. Can you explain that to me? I use that quite a lot when I'm doing interviews with people, even though you know the topic. But sometimes it's helpful to get them to explain the language. But you don't want to get lost. You don't want to be going into depth interview and in actual fact realize you're out of your depth. So you need to do a little bit of work so you're confident before you start interviewing people. What else? Have I included everybody? So always be conscious of those people who have not given you feedback. Should I be doing a bit more? Am I confident I've got to every type of person I want to get to? It's easy to just sort of draw the line and say, well, I've done quite a lot of interviews now, but have you really gone out and got to those people you should get to? And be respectful. Be respectful of, be sensitive to the people's circumstances. Be respectful in their opinions. Even if you like them or don't like them, their opinions are valid. Be respectful in the way you dress, the way you act. Being kind to people, be respectful in being confidential to people. There are a number of aspects you need to be conscious of when you're being interviewed or recruiting people. So that was it, really. Is that helpful?
Yes. Thank you very much.
So,
back to the drawing board.
I mean, I did have a look at your questionnaire, and in itself, though, you know, it's not wrong to ask. No survey is necessarily wrong because you're collecting information. You know, before the challenge for me in looking at a questionnaire like this in advance of coming here is I don't actually know what it is you're wanting to collect. So I don't know if you're asking the right questions because I've utterly no idea what your objectives were in doing the survey. I don't know who you're going to be speaking to either. So it'll be a pointless exercise if you're not doing it with the right people. If I was going to come and give you advice, I'd need to know, first of all, what you want to achieve. I want to know what research you've done to find out your audience as much as you can about your audience in advance. I would sit down with you and design the sample structure to work out how many interviews we need to do if we're going to do a quantitative survey and what the profile should be of those interviews. Then you'd sit down and start writing the questionnaire. If you've got your objectives clearly laid out, and you can usually, your questionnaire usually comes really easy. And even then, because you've also done the personal questions, the collecting personal information questions, usually at the end of the survey, unless you've got some quotas that you need to fill and you ask those questions up front to make sure you've got the right type of people and you've ticked off the people you need. The personal questions are usually at the end. I usually know what analysis I'm going to do of the results. And so the only questions I have, personal details I'll be collecting at the end, would be those groups I'm going to analyse. So I might be looking, I know I'm going to, I want to look at differences by age. I know I want to look at differences about where they live or where they're accommodating. So I might ask those questions at the end. So other than that, you're collecting in a quantitative survey, you're collecting the measurable aspects. Yeah. And your qualitative research should be doing your understanding.
I think just from the few surveys that we've gone out with, we maybe missed a trick on the ethnicity question, in that a lot of a lot of the ones people we've met so far have not been Scottish, have they? They've been other nationalities, actually.
Yeah. Interesting. Yeah, no.
But we don't have a question related to that at all.
Yeah. It's difficult to know, really. There's an element of sort of finger in the air about what factors are important. And that could be, if they've moved here, that's a challenge in themselves. Presumably they don't have the social support that they need around them. They don't know the lay of the land. They don't know the places they can go to. They don't have friends and family they can rely on, people they can ask for advice. All sorts of factors, I suppose, if you think through characteristics of people.
Yes, but apart from the language issues, which can affect your digital confidence.
Yeah.
One lives and learns. We're trying not to feel despair at this point.
I'm sorry, yeah, I know. I think anything you are doing, though, is going to help understanding. You might not know, you'll never realistically know everything.
Yes.
But all you can do is know as much as you can about small parts of the challenge. Yes. And then the next step would be to try and identify ways you can help those the challenges you've identified, the groups of people that you have identified. So you're not going to find a panacea that will solve everybody. All you'll do is you'll understand elements of society and try and come up with creative solutions that will help those. And ultimately, you could test those solutions that you've come up with. So don't feel dispirited, as I think.
You mentioned you've done some work on digital inclusion for yourself.
Yeah, I think it's a long time ago now. Yeah. Though I think, though, we did look at... So this was the late 90s. We were looking at... I do remember looking at those groups who were already digitally engaged. So those people who had... And we did find it was... and then tried to look at those people who are typically not included digitally. And those tended to be older people. They tended to be... those who are lower socioeconomic groups, often there were cultural challenges. I did talk about those who are in, doing the Southeast, there were certain communities where it may be seen as more a male role than a female role, within households where in certain socio or economic groups or cultural groups where the male will make decisions and therefore other elements of the household will just not involve. I mean, it even happens in other households as well, where maybe a dominant character in the group, or even in my household, my wife, who does everything in terms of the bills and making sure that the household finances are paid for, and I'll do the other aspects of society. So it's a long time ago. I think it's sort of the digital aspects. It was often about financial more than cultural. So then it was quite expensive to have broadband or to have a mobile phone. There were challenges amongst young people who moved around a lot. So therefore, then they didn't tend to have internet access because it was landline. Back then they didn't have a mobile phone. I wonder now whether probably now it's changed the other way around, where it's more... young people are more engaged than the more sort of those who are homeowners. So I would bet younger people are more mobile internet access than landline or broadband access.
There's something like interested in starting and talking about the ethics of engagement in the first place with those who are discussed and the duty of care that we have for considering. And you mentioned about the premise being that the research is voluntary always. I'm wondering about formalizing the necessity of paperwork for participant agreements in this type of social research.
Yeah, would you do that? You don't typically get the respondent to write any of their personal information down. You certainly, the things you, as soon as you take somebody's name, in this type of exercise, you don't usually take, in micro research, you don't usually collect somebody's name. So would I ever do that? I'm thinking really hard of when I've actually collected people's respondents' names. And signed a waiver to take part in something. The only time I've ever done that is when it's been something that's commercially sensitive. So they've been given some confidential information that they can't therefore share outside of the group discussion. But I would probably suggest not collecting. And this, even though it's a sensitive subject in some cases, I would suggest not collecting their names and or doing any kind of waiver with these people. I think one try to keep it voluntary and keep it as confidential as possible.
Following that into chain of honor vocabulary into about the story to hear these stories in the newspaper where you find a USB which has sensitive data from NHS patients, etc.
Yep.
Yeah,
that is a very good point. Yeah, if you are recording personal information of people, you should always, your paper questionnaires, you have to separate the personal information from their responses. So your personal information should, and personal information is quite a loose definition of what personal information is. It's anything from obvious things like address, telephone numbers, but also includes. So probably things like even age, where they live, the type of household they're in, anything that's about the characteristics of that individual. You keep that on the last page of your questionnaire. You can record, the way to do it is you have a questionnaire number on your back page of your questionnaire, and you have it on the page with the responses. And you have to separate them and store them separately. The pages with personal information should be destroyed within 3 months of finishing the project. So definitely if you're collecting, if it's recording information, if it's a digital recording of a telephone interview or a group discussion, there should be no identifiers on the recording, on the title of the recording, or in the recording itself of who the people are. So you don't record that information. When you go around the room, taking the names of everybody, you never ask them for their full name, and you certainly don't record that information in a digital recording.
And so you go around the room first.
Do go around the room, explain that, and then quickly then say, it's okay if I put on the digital recorder. It's much safer that way. And even when you're storing the file, you shouldn't say a name of a respondent on the file. The way you would do that when I'm recording information is I have a number for the interview. It's all that's said on the digital file. And separately, I have a spreadsheet which has a list of respondents and who those people are. So you separate that information as much as possible. Responses from personal information. It's a good point to raise.
What a fine from the Information Commissioner.
Question about the coding as well. Something which I'm interested in participatory practice, which is connected to some of the themes.
Coding.
Yeah. So when we're analysing the data which is generated, so if you've got your interview, you've transcribed it, and then you're looking for the keys.
Yeah. You sound like somebody who knows his terminology, because coding is a very specific term used in processing online responses or general responses. Coding is used for is putting those into themes, so that you'll, and then generally what you do is the responses will be given an attribute to which theme it is relates to. So if you're transcribing depth interviews, for example, usually what I do is I'd have them all transcribed, and then I would split up those comments into different files or different in a spreadsheet, different places. So I've got all the themes together, all the responses to a particular theme together. That's the appropriate way to do it. But then when it comes to reporting, I should say a reporting open-ended questions or qualitative research is a challenge in itself. And there are lots of different theories about how you do it. My favourite way is to use a big piece of paper if I'm doing reporting of open-ended comments or qualitative research. And usually I have my... do you know the thing's called spider chart? Mind mapping, that's what it is. And usually I have the main topic in the middle as a bubble, and then off it I would have different other bubbles come off, and even those, so I might round it and think what the main themes were that came out on that topic, and even in each of those you can have either little bubbles that come off that try and the actual fact, and then if you're really good at mind mapping, what you do is you use that spreadsheet and you even number them in order, and that starts writing your report for you. You decide which are most important, and then you translate that onto a piece of paper, and then 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and these are the paragraphs or the sections of my report will be on each of the bubbles.
Have you ever done a research project which involved participants in that stage?
In the reporting stage?
So they were represented in the analysis of what people...
I can't think of one where I have, but you could do. I don't see why that wouldn't be a problem. I've done ones where I used to do a lot of staff research, and often what I do is I'd have a presentation of the results, and then before I write a report, you might have your presentation to staff, and then I might have them in a workshop with those staff to go and discuss what they thought about the results, and then ultimately what they should do about those results. So I might do some follow-up work to engage them in after you've presented the results, trying to get them to come up with solutions.
I guess there's kind of different traditions or emphases or worldviews in different types of research, right? And so it's kind of some of the questions that you raise kind of suggest maybe a more standpoint of research. It's kind of worth, I guess, signposting that up to people. Like,
yeah.
Market researchers have a code of conduct that they work to, that suggests a particular worldview or way of working on research, and generally, the objective of market research will be mostly around finding out the point of, I guess, the closing market.
Yeah.
It's something to do with people buying stuff ultimately.
Well, it depends. You get different kinds of market. I suppose market research is often thought of as being around consumer products and understanding sort of demand for a product. But it's broadly research. But there's social research, and typically social research and market research. And social research is usually understanding society and the challenges facing society. Market research is usually sort of business type research.
And then maybe user research might be another category.
Yeah, I suppose I can, and that can fall into under both, I suppose. Yeah. I think and research is often it's just an element in terms of design or constant process to help people. You're constantly doing research to reevaluating a hypothesis or trying new methods or new techniques.
Because if you were, for example, you were at university, they would come up with some of the answers they would give to some of these questions, and they're slightly different. So it's just worth finding.
Yeah, I suppose. So you can take, ultimately, you take different approaches to how you do the research, and even your approach can have some influence on what type of solutions you come up with. Yeah, sound right? So I don't know how I'm doing for time. I didn't pay any attention. I should be paying attention to time. Didn't do that. Yeah, is that okay?
Thank you.
I'll email it to Alex. Though I didn't. There's probably typos all over the place. I just knocked up a few slides for something to talk about. So, but I'll email that to Alex. Yeah, but don't be scared of it. I mean, I think at the end of the day. Don't be demoralized about your own efforts. What you are doing is trying to understand the topic, and there may be some limitations or some flaws in the way you've done it, and you can understand, as long as you appreciate where we might not have done a full-on robust scientific exercise, I'm still helping to understand the challenges that people face and trying to come up with solutions. There's nothing wrong with that.
Yes. In a sense, really, this survey is acting both as a pre-survey and a survey at the same time.
Yeah.
Because we're trying to understand the act, what we've got to get to grips with.
Yeah, and your time frame is pretty tight.
Yes.
I'd say if I was doing an exercise for a client, I usually know an exercise is going to take about 3 months.
Yes.
Because you'll start off with trying to meeting the client, yes, understanding the objectives. You might do some desk research.
Yes.
You might then have to work with the client to design the survey or the approach you're going to take.
Yes.
Then you have to recruit people.
Yes.
Usually recruiting people a week, 2 weeks before you actually go and meet them. Then the interviewing itself can take you depending on your audience, can take sort of 4 to 6 weeks. Then you've got to process those results. Then you've got to present the results. So it can take a long time. You can't just go, right, I'm going to do a survey, do it next week, and then I'll have results the week after that. It doesn't necessarily work like that.
The script's quite fluid. It's changing all the time, so it's difficult to harness a particular number of people.
Yeah. I think it would be helpful for you if you can do some, if you're doing desk research, to try and understand sort of how many people there are that face this type of challenge and who they are.
Well, we think that there are about 350 roughly within Edinburgh.
Mm-hmm.
Roughly, approximately. So what proportion of those do you think we should try to speak to? What would be a good number?
Yes.
350. You've got one advantage. 350 is not actually a massive population.
Yes. Yes.
So you've got one advantage in that.
Yes.
There's always a balance between sort of the size of your population and the size of, and
yes,
and sort of how many interviews you need to do.
Yes.
350, I mean, you probably, could you get to somewhere between 50 and 100 of those? If you can get to be 50 and 100 of those.
I think we're at about 40 now. So.
Yeah, so that's not bad. I mean, I think you'll know that the results won't be very robust,
yes,
but you can feel quite confident that you've got a mix of people and you've got a range of different views.
Yes.
Quoting the statistics, I would be, you know, be careful with quoting the statistics. So I would suggest have a nice element. Do some qualitative research as well,
yes,
to back up. Either before the survey or after the survey.
Yes.
Go back, if you get some results, go out there and go back to some of those people you've interviewed or go to some different people and try and help understand what some of the results are, whether they're backed up by other students.
Yes. I mean, that raises the issue about anonymity, actually. It's very interesting because, first of all, it's a drifting population, homeless population. We are sampling a number in time. And then, but we wanted to know, if possible, if there were one or two who could potentially, we could profile in more detail,
mm-hmm,
you know, we would want to be able to contact them. So we needed a way of somehow identifying,
yeah,
them as we're interviewing them. Do you know what I'm trying,
yeah,
to say to you? So it's that feeling of...
Well, yeah, I was going to say there's not some ideas. Yeah. You could do that. You could... Yeah, use case studies.
Yes.
It's a good way of highlighting when you come to reporting.
Yes.
And understand, even if you do sort of 4 or 5 individuals,
yes,
but you spend more time with them,
yes,
to go through mapping a day or,
yes,
or, you know, you can more detail about those people. That's a good way to report.
Yes.
Another way, just occurs to me, I'm forgetting what it's called. There's another type of research which involves... ethnography, which is a type of research where you live in the shoes of the individual. Effectively, you're with an individual for a day,
yes,
or where you follow them, and you try to not interfere or change their day, but you understand on a daily, you know, throughout the day,
yes,
how they actually live,
yes,
how they... A typical one is they do that type of research with transport, where,
yes,
you would actually follow someone,
yes,
from their house all the way to their work, so you understand,
yes,
the experiences they face,
yes,
as they go through different parts of the journey.
Yes.
But you might do that with somebody who's a homeless person, to go through their day, to understand how they fill the day, where there may be barriers within their day,
yes,
to being able to access.
Thank you very much.
Yeah,
that was very rich.
Okay. Thanks. You know what I was going to... Hopefully that helped. I didn't really know what to talk about, so
thank
I hope that
you.
Helped.
It was excellent.
Okay.
Good.
And the final question, is there any further reading you recommend? For example, Robert Worcester?
You could look up Bob Worcester, yeah, Bob Worcester. He's a sort of purist in research, but he also you can look up, it's a funny thing that you do all your academic research when you're at sort of, when you're learning to do research, and then you get into the practicalities of it, you don't really quite read as much, you just do it. But look at Bob Worcester. He's a purist in research, and also a chap that he's used to work with was Roger Mortimer. And they may well put a lot of research, even if looking at Ipsos Mori website, they have an archive of all the research they do is on the Ipsos Mori website, and everything that's made publicly available. And to be fair, most of Ipsos Mori's work is government-funded research, so most of that research has to be made publicly available. So I think you probably do. You do want to look and see if there's some research that's been done around either social exclusion or digital exclusion.
Yes. Yes.
There's a good website from IDEO as well called designkit.org.
Okay.
They have more experimental and interactive qualitative approaches.
Mm-hmm.
So empty maps across sorts of like, and you can use to triangulate with the other data that you have.
I can try. Yes, you can get very scientific and very complicated in your group discussions in particular, using different techniques, projective techniques, and exploring, drawing information out of people. You can get creative if you want to get creative in your group discussions. Okay.